6 Minute English from BBC Learning English.
Hello, I'm Rob, and this is 6 Minute English, the show that brings you an interesting topic, authentic listening practice, and some vocabulary to help you improve your language skills.
And hello, I'm Neil. Our topic today is transport. How do you think you'll be travelling to work in, say, 30 years' time, Rob?
Well, not only will homeworking be more prevalent, that means common, but I hope I won't be working in 30 years' time.
Good answer. But if we look back and see how transport has changed in the last 30 years, it makes you wonder what the future holds.
Yes, we've seen how air travel has become commonplace for many people. Commonplace means not unusual. And there's been the development of high-speed train travel. But the main priority has been speed, going faster to make your journeys quicker.
That's true, and we'll be discussing some ideas for making transport even faster soon. But let's not waste any time and speed on to today's quiz question.
Yes, time waits for no one, not even you, Neil. So, can you answer this question? According to Guinness World Records, in which country has the fastest ever train been recorded? Is it in A, China, B, Japan, or C, France?
All these countries have fast trains, but I've heard the Chinese trains go particularly fast, so I'm going to say A, China.
Well, you'll have to wait until the end of the programme to see if you're right. But let's talk more now about the future of transport. One development we hear much about is automation.
Automation means using machines to do work that humans normally do. And in terms of transport, this means driverless vehicles. It won't be too long before we become the passenger in a driverless car.
Scary. And the French train engineering company Alstom is planning to test automated freight trains later this year. The automated train prototype can travel for about 100 kilometres without driver intervention. A prototype is the first version of something which can be tested before it's produced in large quantities.
Of course, some trains are already driven by computers, but there's an exciting plan to develop a form of driverless vehicle that could move you around at 1,123 kilometres per hour.
Come on, Neil, that sounds a bit far-fetched. Like flying cars that we see in sci-fi movies. It's difficult to believe because it's unlikely to happen.
Well, you say that, but it's already being tested in Nevada in the USA and has a name, Hyperloop One.
Ah, tell me more.
The idea is you get loaded into a pod and then you're pushed through a metal tube at high speed, taking you to your destination in minutes rather than hours. Anita Sengupta is the lead systems engineer and says there's nothing scary about it.
The Hyperloop is a maglev train in a vacuum system or in a vacuum tube. And so you can also think of it as an aircraft flying at 200,000 feet. So people don't have any issue flying in airplanes and people don't have any issue going in maglev trains. This is simply combining the two and allows you to be more energy efficient.
So Anita Sengupta explained the type of technology the Hyperloop used. First, she mentioned maglev. That's a short way of saying magnetic levitation.
It's when trains travel on magnetic track rather than conventional rails.
And then she mentioned a vacuum system. A vacuum is a space that has all the air and other gases removed from it. So the tube these pods travel in have no air, so there's no resistance. And these technologies are more efficient and they save energy.
Which is a good thing. This sounds like a great way to travel, but will it take off?
Well, BBC technology correspondent Rory Kethlin-Jones isn't so sure. He thinks it will be quite challenging to convince governments to allow long metal tubes to be built on or below ground.
But we have to try these new technologies, Rob. If we didn't, we'd still be travelling around on horse and cart.
A good point, Neil. And we wouldn't have been able to travel at the great speeds mentioned in today's question. Now, earlier I asked you, according to Guinness World Records, in which country has the fastest ever train travelled? Is it in A, China, B, Japan, or C, France?
And I said A, China.
And you were wrong, Neil.
China
does have some very fast trains, but the fastest recorded train was a maglev from the Central Japan Railway Company, which ran on a test track at a speed of 603 kilometres per hour.
Now, that would make my commute to work very quick. Okay, shall we recap some of the vocabulary we've heard today, starting with commonplace?
Yes, which means not unusual or often seen. For example, free Wi-Fi in coffee shops is commonplace these days.
And very useful it is too. Next, we had automation, meaning using a machine to do something instead of a human. Automation in the car-making industry has led to the loss of hundreds of jobs.
Of course, when you build a new car, you need to make a prototype. That's the first version of something which can be tested before it's produced in large quantities. The prototype of a new solar-powered bike has been so successful that it's now going into mass production.
Come on, Rob, that sounds a bit far-fetched. And by that, I mean so unbelievable it's unlikely to happen.
Well, something people once thought far-fetched is now a reality, and that's maglev. That's short for magnetic levitation, and is how some of the world's fastest trains travel.
Finally, we discussed the word vacuum. It's a space that has had all the air and other gases removed from it, basically an empty space. The plan for Virgin's Hyperloop One is to make a maglev even faster by putting it in a vacuum tube. And that brings us to the end of today's 6-Minute English. Don't forget to check out our YouTube, Facebook, Twitter and Instagram pages, and we'll see you next time. Goodbye.
Bye.
6-Minute English from BBC Learning English.
Hello, this is 6-Minute English from BBC Learning English. I'm Neil.
And I'm Rob.
From the ancient Roman sea god Neptune to myths of mermaids to modern Hollywood films like Finding Nemo, people throughout history have been fascinated by the idea of living underwater. In this programme, we'll be hearing about projects to create livable underwater habitats and the challenges they face.
We'll be finding out how realistic it is to believe that in a few years, we could be eating breakfast whilst watching fish swim outside the kitchen window before heading off to work in an office under the ocean.
And we'll be learning some related vocabulary as well. But first, it's time for our quiz question. One of the first adventure stories to fire the public's imagination about the underwater world was the 1870 novel 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. But who wrote this underwater classic? Was it A, H.G. Wells, B, Arthur Conan Doyle, or C, Jules Verne?
Oh, I think I know this one, Neil. Wasn't it A, H.G. Wells?
OK, Rob, we'll find out later if you're right. Now, one of the most ambitious designs for an underwater city is Ocean Spiral, a huge transparent globe attached to the seabed, the solid ground which lies deep below the sea level.
The top of the globe stands above the surface of the ocean, and running through the centre is a tower to add strength and to provide space for homes, offices and even an amusement park for 5,000 underwater residents.
Ocean Spiral has been dreamt up by the Japanese Shimizu Corporation. Here's Shimizu engineer Maxaki Takeuchi explaining to BBC World Service programme Crowd Science the motivation behind the idea.
At the moment, the world is facing a lot of serious problems regarding food, energy, water, natural resources. However, we are trying to solve the issues just by using our land. Our idea is to connect the sea surface and the deep sea vertically, and that way we believe that we can utilize the capability of the deep sea, and that's the purpose of this whole project.
The effects of human activity on the land have led some to look to the oceans for natural resources, naturally existing things such as minerals, oil, coal and other energy sources that can be used by people.
This search deep underwater is happening vertically, at a 90-degree angle straight up or down from the ground, as opposed to horizontally or flat across the Earth's surface.
But as yet, Shimizu Corporation's plans for an underwater city are still in the planning stages. No part of the project has yet been built, and the total cost is thought to exceed $26 billion.
In fact, the longest anyone has spent living under the sea is only 73 days. That record was set by Roger Garcia, ex-military diver and head of the Aquarius, currently the world's only underwater research station.
Here's Roger Garcia explaining to BBC World Service programme Crowd Science what happens to the human body after living underwater for so long.
Perhaps a change in their voice. Not much, because we're not very deep. That's because the air becomes denser. Physiologically, the most important thing, though, is that since you are, in this case, at 2.5 times atmospheric pressure, you do take on more inert gas. And in this case, since inside the Aquarius, we just breathe normal air, you're going to take on more nitrogen. And depending on how long you stay in the Aquarius, that's going to incur some sort of decompression obligation.
In addition to engineering challenges, living underwater for long periods of time also affects the human body. One example is the bends, or decompression sickness, a serious medical disorder created by nitrogen bubbles in the muscles when returning to the surface of the sea too quickly.
The bends and changes to the voice are examples of how underwater living changes the body physiologically, relating to how the bodies of living humans and animals function.
As divers descend deep below the ocean's surface, there is an increase in atmospheric pressure, the normal air pressure within the Earth's atmosphere. The deeper they dive, the higher the pressure. Physiological reactions, like the bends, are caused by divers incorrectly readjusting to normal atmospheric pressure.
Well, Neil, with so many difficulties, it's no surprise that H.G. Wells' fantasy of living under the sea is still science fiction.
Ah, but are you sure it was H.G. Wells, Rob? In my quiz question, I asked you who wrote the classic underwater adventure 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea.
Yes, and I said A, H.G. Wells.
Which was the wrong answer. It was, in fact, C, Jules Verne, the French author who also wrote Around the World in 80 Days.
In this programme, we've been discussing the challenge of living underwater, going down vertically at a 90-degree angle to the seabed, the solid ground hundreds of metres under the sea.
Ocean explorers search underwater for natural resources, useful materials like coal and oil.
But they face many physiological problems, problems relating to how the human body functions, such as the bends, a painful medical condition caused by returning too quickly to atmospheric pressure, the Earth's usual air pressure.
That's all for this programme, but we hope you'll be diving back into 6-Minute English very soon. Bye for now.
Bye.
6-Minute English from BBC Learning English.
Hello and welcome to 6-Minute English. I'm Dan and joining me today is Neil. Hi, Neil.
Hi, Dan. What's with the protective gear and helmet?
I'm just getting ready for the inevitable rise of the machines. That's the takeover of the world by artificial intelligence, or AI, which some people predict will happen.
Inevitable means cannot be avoided or stopped. Rise of the machines? What do you mean?
It's our topic in this 6-Minute English. We'll be talking about that, giving you 6 related pieces of vocabulary and, of course, our regular quiz question.
That's the first thing you've said that makes any sense. What's the question?
The word robot, as we use it today, was first used in a 1920s Czech play, Rossum's Universal Robots. But before this, what was its original meaning? A, forced labour, B, metal man, or C, heartless thing?
I will go for A, forced labour.
We'll find out if you were right or not later in the show.
OK, Dan, tell me what's going on.
I saw a news article written by BBC technology correspondent Rory Kethlin-Jones about the recent CES technology show in Las Vegas. He interviewed David Hanson, founder of Hanson Robotics, who said it was his ambition to achieve an AI that can beat humans at any intellectual task.
Surely it's a good thing. Better AI and robotics could take over many of the jobs that we don't want to do, or that are so important to get 100% right, like air traffic control. We'd never have another plane crash. It would be infallible because it would be so clever.
Infallible means never failing, and that's what bothers me. What happens when its intelligence surpasses ours? Why should it do what we want it to do?
To surpass something is to do or be better than it. Dan, you've been watching too many movies. Robots fighting humanity is a popular theme. Guess what? Humanity often wins. And besides, we would program the computer to be benevolent.
Benevolent means kind and helpful. But that's just it. Once the intelligence becomes sentient, or able to think for itself, who knows what it will do? We humans are not exactly perfect, you know. What happens if it decides that it's better than us and wants us out of the way?
Don't worry. Asimov thought of that. Isaac Asimov was an American science fiction writer who, among other things, wrote about robots. he came up with three laws that every robot would have to follow to stop it from acting against humanity. So, we're safe.
I'm not so sure. A sentient robot could make up its own mind about how to interpret the laws. For example, imagine if we created an AI system to protect all of humanity.
Well, that's great. No more war. No more murder. No more fighting.
Do you really think that humans can stop fighting? What if the AI decides that the only way to stop us from hurting ourselves and each other is to control everything we do? So it takes over to protect us. Then we would lose our freedom to a thing that we created that is infallible and more intelligent than we are. That's the end, Neil.
I think that's a little far-fetched, which means difficult to believe. I'm sure others don't think that way.
Okay. Let's hear what the Learning English teams say when I ask them if they're worried that AI and robots could take over the world.
Well, it's possible, but unlikely. There'll come a point where our technology will be limited and probably before real AI is achieved.
Never in a million years. First of all, we'd program them so that they couldn't, and secondly, we'd beat them anyway. Haven't you ever seen a movie?
I totally think it could happen. We only have to make a robot that's smart enough to start thinking for itself. After that, who knows what it might do?
A mixed bag of opinions there, Dan. It seems you aren't alone.
Nope. But I don't exactly have an army of support either. I guess we'll just have to wait and see.
Speak for yourself. I've waited long enough. For our quiz question, that is.
Oh, yeah. I asked you what the original meaning of the word robot was before it was used in its modern form. A, forced labour, B, metal man, or C, heartless thing.
And I said A, forced labour.
And you were right.
Shall we take a look at the vocabulary then?
Okay. First we had inevitable. If something is inevitable, then it cannot be avoided or stopped. Can you think of something inevitable, Neil?
It is inevitable that one day the sun will stop burning. Then we had infallible, which means never failing. Give us an example, Dan.
The vaccine for smallpox is infallible. The natural spread of that disease has been completely stopped. After that was surpasses. If something surpasses something else, then it becomes better than it.
Many parents across the world hope that their children will surpass them in wealth, status, or achievement. After that, we heard benevolent, which means kind and helpful. Name a person famous for being benevolent, Dan.
Father Christmas is a benevolent character. After that, we heard sentient. If something is sentient, it is able to think for itself.
Indeed. Many people wonder about the possibility of sentient life on other planets. Finally, we heard far-fetched, which means difficult to believe. Like that far-fetched story you told me the other day about being late because of a dragon, Dan.
I swear it was real. It had big, sharp teeth and everything.
Yeah. And that's the end of this 6-Minute English. Don't forget to check out our Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube pages. See you next time.
Bye.
Bye.
6-Minute English from BBC Learning English.
Hello, this is 6-Minute English from BBC Learning English. I'm Neil.
And I'm Sam.
Are you feeling well, Sam? No headache or sore throat?
No, I feel fine, thanks, Neil. Why do you ask?
Well, I've been reading some inspirational stories about the doctors and nurses fighting COVID. When I was a boy, I always dreamed of becoming a doctor.
Ah, I see. Have you ever been in hospital?
Yes, I have. And I remember the nurse's bedside manner. You know, the kind and caring way that doctors and nurses treat people who are ill.
Nowadays, more and more of the jobs that humans do are being carried out by machines. But I doubt that a doctor's bedside manner could easily be replaced by a robot.
In this programme, we'll be discussing whether the revolution in artificial intelligence, often shortened to AI, could replace human doctors and nurses. We'll be asking, can you imagine a future without doctors?
In fact, machines are already doing some of the jobs traditionally done by doctors, scanning people's bodies to detect skin cancer, for example.
Yes, that's true, Sam, and it links to my quiz question, which is about human skin. It's a well-known fact that skin is the human body's largest organ. But how much skin does the average adult have? Is it A, 2 square metres, B, 3 square metres, or C, 4 square metres?
Of course, our skin gets loose as we age, but I can't believe there's 3 square meters of it. I'll say the answer is A, 2 square meters.
OK, we'll find out if that's correct later. Every year in the UK, over 5 million people are treated for skin cancer. Catch it early and your chances of survival are increased.
Usually a skin specialist or dermatologist will examine your skin using a handheld microscope. But in 2017, a team of researchers at Stanford Medical School made an exciting announcement.
Here's Oxford University researcher Daniel Susskind telling BBC World Service programme The Big Idea what the medics at Stanford had invented.
A team of researchers at Stanford last year announced the development of a system that if you give it a photo of a freckle, it can tell you as accurately as 21 leading dermatologists whether or not that freckle is cancerous.
The Stanford medical team had invented an AI system to analyse freckles, small brown spots found on people's skin, especially on pale skin.
As it turned out, the AI programme was better than doctors at telling whether a freckle was harmless or cancerous, connected to some type of cancer.
So it seems that artificial intelligence is already replacing humans when it comes to detecting cancer and doing a better job of it.
But Daniel Susskind isn't convinced. One reason is that AI systems still need humans to program them. And as it turns out, knowing exactly how doctors detect illness remains something of a mystery.
Here's Daniel Susskind again in conversation with BBC World Service programme The Big Idea.
If you ask a doctor how it is they make a diagnosis, they might be able to point you to particularly revealing parts of a reference book or give you a few rules of thumb, but ultimately they'd struggle. They'd say, again, it requires things like creativity and judgment, and these things are very difficult to articulate. And so traditionally it's been thought very hard to automate. If a human being can't explain how they do these special things, where on earth do we begin in writing instructions for a machine to follow?
Most doctors find it difficult to explain how they make a diagnosis. Their judgment about what someone's particular sickness is made by examining them.
Diagnosing someone's illness is complicated, but there are some rules of thumb. A rule of thumb is a practical but approximate way of doing something.
For example, when cooking, a good rule of thumb is 2 portions of water to 1 portion of rice.
Exactly. And because identifying sickness is so difficult, Daniel says, where on earth do we begin writing instructions for a machine? We use phrases like where, how, or what on earth to show feelings like anger, surprise, or disbelief.
I might show surprise by asking Sam, how on earth did you know the answer to that?
Aha! I guess you're talking about your quiz question, Neil. And you needn't be so surprised. I'm naturally brainy.
Of course you are. In my quiz question, I asked Sam how much skin there is on an adult human body.
And I said it was A, 2 square metres.
Which was the correct answer. With your brains, I think you'd make a good doctor, Sam, and I'm sure you'd have a good bedside manner too.
Ah, you mean the kind and caring way that doctors and nurses treat their patients. OK, let's recap the rest of the vocabulary, starting with freckle, a small brown spot on someone's skin.
Freckles are usually harmless, but some skin spots can be cancerous, connected to cancer.
A doctor's diagnosis is their judgment about what someone's particular sickness or disease is.
A rule of thumb is a useful but approximate way of doing or measuring something.
And finally, we use phrases like, where on earth, as a way to show emotions like anger, surprise, or disbelief.
That's all for this programme, but join us for the next edition of 6 Minute English, when we'll discuss another trending topic and the related vocabulary.
Why on earth would you miss it? Goodbye for now.
Goodbye.
6 Minute English from BBC Learning English.
Hello, this is 6 Minute English from BBC Learning English. I'm Neil.
And I'm Rob.
From the bubonic plague to cholera and tuberculosis, disease and pandemics have changed the way cities have been built. For example, buildings in 19th century Paris were designed with large, high-up windows to allow plenty of sunlight. They were supposed to stop the spread of tuberculosis.
Coronavirus has been no different. In lockdown, cities from Rio to Barcelona were transformed as wildlife and birdsong replaced the noise of taxi horns and traffic. And with no car pollution, you could even see the stars at night.
In this programme, we'll be asking if cities after lockdown will ever be the same again, and if we want them to be.
We'll be hearing some ideas from different cities around the world.
And of course, we'll be learning some new vocabulary along the way. One of the cities most affected by COVID-19 was Mumbai in India. But approximately how many people were affected? What's the estimated population of Mumbai? That's my quiz question for you today, Rob. Is it A, 15 million people, B, 20 million people, or C, 25 million people?
I know Mumbai is an international mega city, so I'll say B, 20 million people.
Okay, Rob, we'll find out later if that's right. Now, Beatrice Colomina is a professor of architecture at Princeton University in the United States. She spent years researching the relationship between cities and disease. Here she is talking with Kavita Puri, presenter of BBC World Service programme The Inquiry.
Take tuberculosis. Unlike cholera, which was eliminated in London by redesigning the sewage system in the 1850s, TB was airborne.
But it became really a problem with the rise of the industrial cities, the metropolis, before an antibiotic was effective.
One in seven people on the planet had TB, but in dense cities like Paris, it was one in three. Closely packed tenements meant the disease spread like wildfire, and architects and planning experts responded.
Some diseases like cholera could be prevented by redesigning cities to improve hygiene, like the wastewater sewers in 19th century London. But the problem with tuberculosis, or TB for short, was that the disease is airborne, carried and spread in the air.
Adding to the problem was the fact that antibiotics, medicines like penicillin that can destroy harmful bacteria or stop their growth, was not discovered until 1928, too late to save thousands of people who died in Mumbai, New York, Paris, and other cities during the 1800s.
Diseases like TB killed more and more people as cities industrialised and grew bigger and bigger, leading to the creation of the metropolis, the largest, busiest, and most important city in a country or region.
Many people crowded together in large metropolises, meaning that disease could spread like wildfire, an idiom meaning spread quickly around many people.
Even today, disease is shaping our cities. In post-COVID Paris, new ideas for a 15-minute city aim to make all public services available within a 15-minute walk to help people working from home.
Other countries want to build better, more affordable housing outside the city centre.
But according to Mumbai resident Dr. Vardi Tandel, this won't work, even if the housing on offer is better. But why? The reason is work.
When you shift them out, you're moving them away from their livelihoods and they're not going to be able to sustain themselves there. So they will be coming back because their jobs are in the city and they cannot afford the commute from farther off places.
Dr. Vardi Tandel there, talking on the BBC World Service programme The Inquiry. Trying to make cities less crowded is one way to minimise the risks from disease. But moving people away from the city centre means moving them away from their livelihood, their job, or other way of earning money to pay for food, housing and clothing.
Many people still want to live near their workplace in the city centre because they can't afford to pay for the commute, the journey between their home and their place of work.
Yeah, which is a real problem when you live in a city of... How many people did you say live in Mumbai, Neil?
Yes. In our quiz question, I asked you what the estimated population of Mumbai is.
I said B, 20 million people.
And you were absolutely right. Around 20 million people live in the Mumbai metropolis, making it very difficult to socially distance.
In this programme, we've been discussing the relationship between cities and disease. In the 1800s, tuberculosis, or TB, killed thousands because it was an airborne disease, spread in the air and hard to prevent.
Antibiotics, medicinal chemicals like penicillin, which can destroy harmful germs, couldn't help because they weren't discovered until decades later.
So in metropolises, the largest and most important cities where people live, crowded close together, diseases spread like wildfire, an idiom meaning spread widely and quickly.
In Mumbai and other places, the problem remains that many people need the city for their livelihood, job or other way of earning money.
So they prefer to live in the city centre instead of paying for the daily commute, a journey often by train, bus or car from your home to your workplace.
And that's all we have time for in this programme, but remember you can find more useful vocabulary, trending topics and help with your language learning here at BBC Learning English. Bye for now.
Bye-bye.
6 Minute English from BBC Learning English.